Here we have an original iPad 1. This was gifted to me by Auntie, and basically it does not work. Why doesn't it work? Because, like many old or obsolete products, it was placed on a shelf after it got replaced by iPad 2, 3, whatever, and down the line and down the line. Well, what happens is, because it sat on the shelf for so long, the battery eventually died and dropped below the iPad's cutoff level. And basically the battery management said, okay, the battery went too low, there might be something wrong with it, or it might have shorted out, or some other idea that it might have had, and I'm not going to let it be charged anymore. Now, usually you drop a whole bunch of money and get a replacement new battery. But if there's nothing wrong with it, why do that? In this case, it just self-discharged below that little bit of a cutoff level, and there's most likely absolutely nothing wrong with the battery. So I'm not going to go through all the steps on how to disassemble your iPad. There's plenty of videos out there, but what we are going to do is I show you how to access the direct battery terminals to put some charge back in the battery to bring it up to a level where it says, oh, okay, I guess the battery's fine, the voltage is at a good level, I'll let you charge it and use the product normally now. So I actually had taken this off, did not need to do, apparently, because I had started, originally I was going to remove the whole battery before I saw that, I only had to peel off some tape. So disregard this piece right here. Just pretend that's still connected. I have the screws over here. I'm going to put those back in later because I want to dig into this a little bit more. See if while I'm at it, I can boost the Wi-Fi range. Now, there's this thick black insulating tape covering the battery packs. If you very carefully, and do not use any metal tools to do so, peel back the tape towards the top of the iPad on the batteries. You can see the strips right there. Peel the tape off, and if you see, there is a now bare direct battery cable terminal there, the tab, another one there. Another one here, another one here. Now, I actually only had to peel off on one of the batteries. This is a whole, but there's actually two cells in here, totaling a total of 24.8 watt hours. They're actually both connected together, and I wasn't sure if that was the case. I wasn't sure if the battery management board had each cell separate or if it had them both connected directly together. I found they are connected together, and I labeled them positive, negative. Now, to be on the safe side, always verify on your own, for your own specific device, if you are going to attempt this. But we are at 2.28 volts per cell. That is too low. So we want to bring that up. Now, I have a special benchmarking lithium charger here. Actually, it'll charge just about any portable style cell. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to use this to put a little juice back into these batteries here. So I have just a little adapter that I got and use some alligator clips. So let's see which one has the best space on there for me. I think we're going to go over here, clamp one on there, and then I'm going to go, I think, over to this one here. You gotta be careful not to touch any of the surrounding metal so you don't short anything out. So right now, oops, slot, mode, no, I don't want to discharge, I could even benchmark test. So I'm going to put some power back in. I could actually do up to 2 amp. But because these cells are so low, you want to try and do it at a lower level. You can use pretty much any lithium charger. I just like to play on the safe side and a nice low current. Okay, so it's charging at 200 milliamp. I mean, this is actually a really high capacity battery. So The BMS should be good at about 3.2 to 3.5 volts to charge via the standard charger. So we're going to cut the video now, and I'm going to let this go. I could even let it go all the way till full if I wanted to. Benchmark the batteries to see how much capacity has been lost over time. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to get enough in there. I'll probably go to 3.5 volts, roughly, and then let the iPad itself take care of the remainder of the charger. So let's cut the video. Already up to 2.71. Now, chances are, if your iPad has done this, it has suffered some permanent battery capacity loss at the same time. So do not expect the same runtime out of it. For me, I'm actually going to be mounting this one on the wall and have it display real-time YouTube stats for my channel, as well as live comments. And since iPad 1 doesn't have a camera, I can't use it for live streaming or anything like that. And so I'm going to use it like that. They're such low-powered devices. Cost next to nothing to keep operational. And I might use it for watching Netflix while I'm working in my office. We are back. It actually took quite a while on my special smart charger to get enough power into the iPad. And I did test it to make sure I had enough power in there, as it's very finicky of when it turns back on. But basically, let's just get a quick up-close look. You're not going to see anything. So basically, where I had it clamped into, then I resealed it using insulating tape, and I got it until about 3.85 volts. What I could find online was that it will not turn on if there's anything lower than 3.8 volts. So I figured, let's just let her go. I think I put in a total of about, 4.5 amp hours into this thing. According to the iPad, 77% battery. And that's what it got by me charging it on my analyzer. And there we go. It is now charging off the Apple charger. That's what it is. Extension cord's coming out of the socket, but there we go. Charging off of the standard Apple charger using a 88-cent third-party charging cable, and it is charging. I now have a pretty much completely usable iPad 1. I just hope I can get some sort of Netflix on here for working in the office. But that is how you jumpstart an iPad 1. Smile, cheese!